done for me. Welcome here, everybody. Welcome to College Drive. If you're joining us online or everybody here, we're just happy to see you. And why don't you guys stand with me? I'll lead us off with a word of prayer and keep going. Father God, we just come before you today and we thank you for who you are, what you do, and how you move in each of us. Lord, I pray that today you just show yourself to us in some way here through the message or through the songs. Lord, we love you so much, and we pray that you just lead us and guide us. And we thank you so much. We pray this all in your name. Amen. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm.
louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive.
He wraps himself in light.
darkness tries to hide and trembles at his voice and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how. The same God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. And yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. All my days, oh yes, I will. And yes, I will lift you high in the Lord. joy when my heart is heavy. You high in the lowest valley, yes, I will bless your name, and yes, I will live for joy when my heart is heavy. Valley, yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
All right, you guys may be seated. Morning, church. Thank you. It's actually so name. Awesome. Thank you so much. All right. In case you didn't hear that, my name is Carson. I am the Youth Young Adults pastor here, and it's great to see you guys here this morning. I just got a few quick announcements here, and then I'm going to hand over to Wayne. But first and foremost, if you're a new visitor here, welcome. Nice to meet you. And we have a few gifts for you up at the welcome desk. And so there's a few beautiful people up there that want to hang out with you, talk with you, and also give you a gift. And so if you're new here, or if you're new within the past few weeks, just go up to the welcome desk, say hi, say, hey, this is my first, second-ish time. And then, yeah, you get a little gift over there. It's pretty sweet, I would say. There's also activity boxes in case your kids are feeling a little antsy, or maybe you're feeling a little antsy, you just need a draw or something. There's activity boxes over at the front, just over that door and then to the right. Yeah, just some activity boxes because we don't have kids' quests going on today, but we do have activity boxes. So yeah, if you need that as well. And speaking of kids' quest, we actually have a volunteer meeting. This is actually not just for volunteers. If you're wondering, like, if you're wanting any information about kids' quest, or if you're like, oh, hey, like, I want to get involved a bit more, but I don't know what it's about, like, this is a great opportunity for you to get to know what Kid Quest is about. And so it's happening right after the service on August 25th. And yeah, Michelle Cooling, I believe she's the one that's going to be running that. And so talk to her and, yeah, get a bit more information from her as well. The Gulp, our lunch ministry for students, is happening again September 11th. And in case you actually, yeah, don't know about that, that's been happening for decades at this point. It's been happening for a long time. And Charmaine's going to be looking for more volunteers in the next few weeks. And so if you're wanting to help out with that, if you have Wednesdays to be able to do that, go speak with her. It's a really cool opportunity just to be able to see what's happening in the college life around here. And there's a lot of people that come through this building specifically that, yeah, we don't really get to see on a Sunday. And so it'd be a really great opportunity if you want to be able to serve. Talk to Charmaine, and yeah, we can get you hooked up with that. That'd be super cool. And our ministry kickoff day, that's the day when we have people come in here if you're wanting to volunteer, or this is just a kickoff for the fall as well. That's happening September 15th, and so that, again, that's right after the service, and so we're going to be having a bunch of stuff. We're going to have bouncy castles for you older kids. If you still want to go on bouncy castles, I guess, if you still want to do that, that's fun. You're totally welcome to. And we have face painting, that's also pretty cool, and some food as well. So yeah, if you want to come hang out after the service and just, yeah, be with us together, that'll be super fun. And so that's all I got for announcements. I'm going to invite Wayne up to give us our financial update. So thanks, Wayne.
Good morning. My name is Wayne Braun. I'm part of four people on the Finance Committee, and I want to bring you a bit of an update for the end of July 31st of this year. As you can see, our budgeted revenues for the first 7 months of the year was $260,000, and our expenses were budgeted at just under $260,000. Our actual revenues are $196,000, and our expenses are $243,000. Part of that, the budget for the first 7 months of the year was $16,000 that we did to replace air conditioning unit on the education wing. We had to replace the copier in the office with a refurbished copier for $5,000. And we also spent about $8,000 on upgrading our front doors coming into the church. So all of our major project work is now done for the fiscal year. I just wanted to bring to your attention that our budgeted donations and revenues for the first 7 months are some $65,000 below target. Part of that is due to the month when we move into summer, giving goes down a bit. However, our budgeted expenditures stay roughly even throughout the year, so we have fallen about $65,000 behind on our revenues. Part of that is cushioned by the fact that we have not filled that position that was advertised back in the spring, so that has cushioned some of our shortfall. Just a reminder that we want to continue our responsibilities towards our budget as we get to the end of the year. We have 5 months left, and we have a significant piece to catch up on. We are very grateful as a finance committee for all the donations and efforts that people have made in contributing towards our budget. And we trust that we will remain faithful as we approach the end of our fiscal year this year. Thanks.
Good morning. I'll just start off this morning by saying that if anybody wants to pray with me after the service, I will come up here and be happy to pray with you. So I've been reading through a devotional book that's titled Experiencing God Day by Day, and I'm going to just share a portion of one of the devotionals because it's something that I need to be reminded of. I'm not very good at sitting in the presence of God, and this was a good reminder for me. God designed worship for us to see him in his glory and to respond appropriately. For many, it has degenerated into religion, one more meeting to attend out of habit. God gave us prayer so that we could have conversation with him. But we often distort this by saying prayers and hurrying off without ever listening to what is on our Father's heart. Jeremiah 2, verse 6 reads, "Neither did they say, 'Where is the Lord who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, who led us through the wilderness?'" Religious activity apart from fellowship with God is empty ritual. The people of Jeremiah's day were satisfied to have the ritual without the manifest presence of God. They became so comfortable with their religion that they didn't even notice God's absence. It is possible to pray, to attend a worship service, or to give an offering, yet not experience the presence of God. Don't settle for a religious life that lacks a vital relationship to Jesus Christ. When God is present, the difference will be obvious. Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you are the Prince of Peace and the great I Am. You are our helper and our Redeemer, and we want to quiet our hearts before you this morning. Take a moment to give praise to God for something he has done in your life this week, or listen to what is on the Father's heart for you today. Lord, we come here today because we need you and we want to hear from you. Help us to focus on you and give all of our anxious thoughts to you. We give you praise for being unchanging, all-knowing, all-powerful, ever-present, unending in your love for us, and perfect in all your ways. Help us to be a body that worships you not out of habit or practice, but rather knowing that each of your commands is intended to enhance your love relationship with your people. Thank you, God, that you have given us this church family. And I also thank you for each family that is represented within our body. May you give a time of refreshing to families in these last weeks of summer as they continue to travel, attend camp, or simply spend time together. I pray that you would give an extra measure of strength and endurance to those who are leading at summer camps so that they can finish well. And may those who have renewed or begun a relationship with you at camp this summer continue to seek you in their everyday life as they go back to their routines. God, this morning I think of all those who are preparing to go back into the classroom, some of whom have lost everything to wildfire. I can't even imagine what that is like and what they are experiencing right now. And God, I just ask that you give your peace that passes all understanding to those who are navigating so much devastation and loss. I also ask that you would surround those in our body who have recently lost loved ones or who are recovering from surgery. Surround them with your presence and spur us on to pray and help in tangible ways to support one another as you have commanded. I also pray for Carson and all of the other youth leaders who are gearing up for fall. And I pray that they could continue to be purposeful in their leadership so it is clear that you are the reason they are gathering. I pray that you would pour out your spirit on them as they continue to serve you. Lord, now I lift up Pastor Kimbal to you as we continue to hear about how you have moved mightily behind the scenes to accomplish your purpose and protect your people, and help us to look for and listen to how you are moving amongst your people even now. Help our hearts to be open to receive what you would have us to hear. And we will give you all the glory. I pray this in your precious name. Amen.
Well, good morning. It is good to be here. I'm not going to be here the next couple Sundays because we're wrapping up camp this week and then going away for a couple weeks vacation. Woohoo! Some of you that have said, yeah, vacation, it's highly overrated. Been there, done that. I don't know if anyone ever says that, actually. But hopefully you have had some vacation. I don't know why my computer is not working. Come on. Open up. Okay. I'll just wing it. No, it's okay. I do want to say thank you again for your prayers on our behalf, for Tanya and I and all those that are from our church. We have just a good number that are serving at camps, and I know you hear it week after week, and camps is a big part of our summer, and so it kind of, you know, filters into here, but this is our last week, so we have family camp that's starting today. It's a short week, so it goes till Thursday, and we have a staff camp, which is something that's new for us at SABC, and so that's kind of our 14 to 17-year-olds that have been serving intermittently throughout the summer. We invite them back and just have fun together, so I get to speak to that. So you can remember me in prayer this week, every evening, and then Thursday we wrap up, have a big celebration, party, worship night, and then Friday is just cleaning, cleaning, cleaning. And then we are booking out of here on Saturday early morning, going to see our kids and a bit of time after that. So, yes. This is weird that my computer has crashed fully. I might have to sneak your notes back there, Ryan. Maybe someone could run those up to me. It's a Mac. That doesn't happen. Except now you don't have any notes, so you're just going to have to follow along. You're good. You're professional. All right. That's good. Okay. But you were on the wrong page. Okay. Sorry. Here we go. All right. First, before we get into today's sermon, which will kind of wrap up our Esther series, I want to just say a bit about where we're going from here. So next Sunday, one of our preaching team, Eric Reno, who is one of our preachers in training, he is the preacher in training as of right now. So he's speaking next week, and he's going to talk about living beyond the rules, sort of a one-off in between series. And then the week after that is a long weekend, September long weekend, and that is going to be another one of our outdoor services, praise and sharing. Carson's going to be leading through that. And then I'll be back for the 8th Sunday, kind of leading in a bit. And then the 15th, as Carson mentioned, is our kickoff, and we'll also be starting in on a new sermon series, which will take us through a good chunk of the year. And this series is going to be called The Story, and it's based on a material that is written by a couple of guys that I can't remember their names right now. Oh man, blanking today. But anyways, it's a curriculum for life groups, but it also is a sermon series that we're going to build around it based on 31 key stories in Scripture. It's pretty hard to pull out all the details of Scripture, but we're going to walk through these 31 key stories, kind of painting a picture of the upper story of what God is doing, and then the lower story that is happening kind of on the ground, and this overarching narrative of Scripture. Because we realize, as we kind of pop in and out of different books of the Bible, and we try to lay the context at times of where a book like Galatians or Mark or wherever we land or Esther, we paint the picture, but it's really all the pieces of a puzzle, and we want to lay out kind of the overarching story all in one, because that helps us to have biblical literacy, which helps us to have biblical fluency. How do we actually live out the Bible? But we need to know the story. And so I know some of you have grown up going to Sunday school and you know all these little kind of pockets of the story, but a reminder that it all fits together. And we're going to walk through that and also include that with life groups. And so if you're interested in joining life groups and working through that, you can sign up for those and we will connect you in that way. All right, so as far as Esther goes, we've referred a couple times to one commentary has been a key one, and it's by a woman named Karen Jobes, and she's brilliant, has a great commentary, and I was going to bring it up as well, but I can refer to it on our social media or something. If you want to get that, it's pretty user-friendly. If you want to dig a little bit deeper into Esther, because there's so much to unpack, and today we're going to do chapters 8 through till the end, and won't be able to cover everything in there. So if you want a little bit more detail, some things catch your attention, you want to dig a little deeper, that's a good resource for you. Okay. The year was 1920. Some of you saw that date well. Anyone? It used to be that there was those around us that were born in the 1920s. Maybe there are some of you, but I think you'd be getting up there. But 1920 was the year, and the New York Yankees, they bought Babe Ruth's contract from the Boston Red Sox. And this prompted what was known as the Curse of the Bambino. For 86 years, this curse loomed over the Red Sox, including 4 World Series Game 7 losses. Now, some of us are just recovering from the Oilers, you know, recent Game 7 loss. But if you've been a Boston Red Sox fan in your life, you know the pain. 4 times they reached the World Series final, Game 7, and lost. And so this was the thought. This was all based on this curse of the Bambino, is what was suggested. But then, 2004, the Boston Red Sox faced the New York Yankees in the American League Championship Series, 7 games. And the first 3 games of the series, the Red Sox lost. Suddenly, before they knew it, they were down 3-0. And then, in that game four, they were down 4-3 in the bottom of the ninth inning. Things looked pretty grim. Things were going to go the way that they felt it had always been going. But then, in the bottom of the ninth inning, they tied it, went into extra innings, and then off the bat of David Ortiz, Big Poppy, they proceeded to win that game and then won games 5, 6, and 7, and then the World Series in 4 straight games against St. Louis Cardinals. Now, some of you are going, I don't really care, baseball. What is it, like 168 games of the year? Who knows? Who cares? All this to say, I'm not a big baseball fan, but I was interested in this idea. Not that I believe in a curse, but I believe I wanted to see it change. I want to see it broken, that the curse would be broken. And here it was. And you also can watch all that you need to know about this in the wonderful rom-com movie Fever Pitch. That was a joke. I'm just kidding. It is based on that. All right. How many of you like comeback stories, though? You like a good comeback stories? Yes. How many of you were cheering for the Edmonton Oilers? Okay, some of you were. We hoped that there was going to be this possibility that they could, in fact, do what hardly anyone had ever done before and had come back against all odds. We like it in movies where there's something that happens. There's a great reversal. There's a switch, some pivotal moment, and then everything turns on a dime, and fortunes are changed. I like the movie and the book, Count of Monte Cristo. It's probably not the best example in this, but it's kind of that idea of, you know, fortunes reversed, what was down and out. And, I mean, it's kind of a revenge story, but it's something that just all of a sudden things change, circumstances change, tides turn, tables turn. When all hope is lost, situations reversed, and then victory is secured. Well, this on a grand scale is what we've seen in the book of Esther. So today, this is where we're going, and we're going to look at a little bit of the conclusion, the rest of the story, and then these three things. We're going to look at King Xerxes' counter decree. Secondly, we got to look at some of the moral issues that are presented in this story that we can't ignore. And then thirdly, the king of all heaven, his ultimate counter decree. And I'll just say this, is that we've had some really solid kind of reviews and overviews of the book the last few weeks. I'm not going to review everything again. So if you need to kind of catch up, or if you're new with us today, hopefully you won't be too out of it, but you can go back and catch up and watch through the series to see where we are, we've been coming from. All right, so first of all, I'll get you in your Bibles or in your scripture journals to turn to chapter 8 of Esther. So first of all, here we go. We got King Xerxes, the counter decree. And that decree, the first one, was that all the Jews would be annihilated, eliminated. That came through the evil plot of Haman. And so now here we are in chapter 8. And I'll read verse 1 to 8. On that day, King Xerxes gave to Queen Esther the house of Haman, the enemy of the Jews. And Mordecai came before the king, for Esther had told what he was to her. And the king took off his signet ring, which he had taken from Haman, and gave it to Mordecai. And Esther set Mordecai over the house of Haman. Then Esther spoke again to the king. She fell at his feet and wept and pleaded with him to avert the evil plan of Haman the Agagite and the plot that he had devised against the Jews. When the king held out the golden scepter to Esther, Esther rose and stood before the king. Verse 5, and she said, "If it please the king, and if I have found favor in his sight, and if the thing seems right before the king, and I am pleasing in his eyes, let an order be written to revoke the letters devised by Haman the Agagite, the son of Hammedatha, which he wrote to destroy the Jews who are in all the provinces of the king. For how can I bear to see the calamity that is coming to my people? Or how can I bear to see the destruction of my kindred? Then King Xerxes said to Queen Esther and to Mordecai the Jew, "Behold, I have given the house of Haman, and they have hanged him on the gallows because he intended to lay hands on the Jews. But you may write as you please with regard to the Jews in the name of the king and seal it with the king's ring, for an edict written in the name of the king and sealed with the king's ring cannot be revoked." Okay, just a few notes, observations from these verses. First of all, we see that Haman's estate is given to Esther. So he's been hanged, he's been impaled on what he was setting up for Mordecai. It came back on him, and so now he is gone, and now what to happen with his estate? Well, Persian law indicated that if you were a criminal, the king could decide what to do with your estate. He'd give it to whoever he wanted. And so what does he do? He gives it to Esther. All of his estate is given to her, and then she gives it to Mordecai to oversee. We see that Mordecai here is promoted to the role of prime minister. Again, the role that Haman had now comes to Mordecai, second in line of the throne, second king, second place. Esther, we see that she comes to the king. And it seems like she really knows at this point, from where she's come as a young girl, very innocent, and now where this is years later as the queen, she is still fearful of her life. And as we've heard, she said, "I come before the king. If I die, I die." But she seems to know how to play this guy, and so she falls at his feet. She weeps and she pleads with him. And so here she's really playing on his ego, on his power. And, I think it is a case, you know, as a woman. So I'm not going to say that because that could sound wrong. I'll just leave it there. Sometimes I stop, even when my wife is in my head saying, "Don't say that." Okay. All right, so here's what she does. She puts the blame on Haman. It's kind of a note there, right? Because what happens is she is actually drawing back from the story, but she pulls the king's name out of the story, at least the author does. But she's saying to the king, this is what Haman did, even though the king is completely implicit in this, right? He's the one, even though he was probably hammered when he was signing this, and the Haman's like, "Hey, this is the idea, we should wipe out these people, you know, and everything," and King's like, "Cool, go ahead and do it." And so he's implicit in it. He's the king. He's the one that's put the stamp on and everything, but she doesn't draw the attention to that. She says it was Haman, right? So she's kind of giving him a bit of an out. "It wasn't your idea, we know. It was just Haman. Put it on him." Note that her plea is to revoke it. That's what she desires. She says, can you change it? Can you eliminate this evil decree?" Verse 7, the king is saying that he thought he's kind of solved the issue, right? He says, I've taken Haman. He's been hung, given him all of his estate to you, and here you go. He's out of the way. Note that it says, why was he hanged? Because he intended to lay hands on the Jews. That's what it says. But if you remember back in the story, it was actually the out that he chose was because when he entered into the room, he saw that Haman had lost his balance and fell onto the couch where Esther was lying. And he said, "What are you trying to do? You know, are you molesting the queen?" And that's the excuse that he gave for why Haman was hung. But here, it says it was because he intended to lay hands on the Jews. So he knew this, he knew it all along what was the real reason. And so here the king does what he's done now several times in this story. He does what he always does, passes the buck, just says, "Write whatever you want. Write whatever you want." Really, this king is the guy, right? Sharp guy. All right, so that's that. Now we come to verse 9, and here's the counter decree. This is the answer. This is what's going to be the solution to the issue in their minds. Verse 11 and 12, talks about, this is what the decree will do. It will saying that the king allowed the Jews who were in every city to gather and defend their lives. If you have a journal or your Bible, you say, circle that word, defend. That's an important word. To defend their lives, to destroy, to kill, and to annihilate any armed force of any people or province that might attack them, children and women included, and to plunder their goods. On one day, throughout all the provinces of King Xerxes, on the 13th day of the 12th month, which is the month of Adar. Okay, so some observations on this, now this counter decree. First of all, we see that there was no revoking it. He couldn't just, eliminate it, scratch that one out. That was Persian law. You could not revoke what had previously been decreed. And I think that there is a bit of a sense here that what the author of Esther in his writing is saying, this is not a really great legal system that's going on here. That, whatever the king decides on a good day, bad day, whether he's out of his mind, whether he's drunk, it doesn't matter. He puts down his rule. It cannot be revoked. So it can't be revoked. So instead, they do a counter decree, which is this provision, and it's a provision for defense. Okay, so you can't change it, can't cancel it, but we can actively allow you to defend yourself against your attackers, to gather and defend your lives. Now, here's a issue. We're going to wait a minute. It says women and children included. And I just want to point this out. If you have an NIV version, what they've done in the NIV is kind of made it a little bit more palatable, and they've kind of they've chosen to say protect themselves to destroy and kill and annihilate the armed men who might attack them and their women and children, as if it was the Jews, women and children, that were also being protected from attack. But if you have your ESV journal, it says something different. It says those who might attack them, children and women included. So it's just flipping it, saying now you have the right in your defense to also destroy, kill, and annihilate the Persian women and children. So it's a difference. Now, why is this kind of, it's challenging when we have translations that say some things different. But I think the idea of why we'd probably want to stick with what the ESV says and some other translations, that it's included, is because what's happening is, as Russ mentioned last week, there's this chiastic structure. There's all the things that happened originally and to Haman and the decree and everything that's being reversed and now coming back to Mordecai and to the Jews. It's all the same language that's being used in structure. And so that was what the original decree was saying about attacking, annihilating, destroying all the Jews, their women and children. And now it's going back and flipping it in reverse. So if you're confused about that, and if it's like, that's troubling, hold that thought. Notice that it says that they were allowed to plunder, okay? But, and I'll get you to mark this down in your journal too, the three times, and that's anytime it's repeated something in scripture, in a narrative like this, we gotta take note, what's the author saying? So three times, it says in their defensive attacks, it says that they actually did not take plunder. So even though the counter decree said they were allowed to, it didn't. So in verse 10, and verse 15, and verse 16, each of those instances, it says, but they did not take plunder, even though they were allowed to in the decree. Now, why does this matter? Well, again, it might just be something that's referring to in the original story that we've referred to several times in this series about King Saul. And King Saul, the decision and the Lord's decree at that time to instructions to Saul that he should wipe out the Amalekites, all right, and destroy everything and not take plunder. King Saul does the opposite. He doesn't destroy them according to the instructions of God. And he does take plunder, and he says, oh, I'm just going to devote this to the Lord. So this is almost like a reverse of that and saying they're going to make right what Saul messed up. Now we see the response to this counter decree in verse 17. It says it was light and gladness and joy and honor. And then it says that, and people became Jews, which is a kind of a curious statement. This counter decree had a completely different effect than the original one by Haman, which, you know, it brought sadness, it brought confusion by everybody. And here there's light and gladness and joy and honor. Now, when it says that people became Jews, it seems to indicate that they became Jews out of fear, right? And so maybe more out of fear than an actual sincerity. But we don't know. Okay, let's look at some of the moral issues that we can't ignore. This is how we, when we come to a book like Esther, and it's got some language and some military language and this type of thing, it kind of messes us up, right, in our current day, the lens that we see life through today in 2024. And so it's something we still have to wrestle with when we see it in Scripture. And so in reading Esther, we're confronted with some moral ambiguity on their part. We see Esther 9, verse 5. This is the way it's written. The Jews struck all their enemies with the sword, killing and destroying them, and did as they pleased to those who hated them. So again, it was active defense, and yet it's still pretty violent. And that's messy in our systems, how that works. Then we see in Esther 9, verse 13, after the one day that was assigned, okay, so in the original decree, there was one day when the Persians could inflict this decree on the Jews and annihilate them. One day. Now, the counter decree says one day the Jews could actively defend themselves. And so they do that on the one day. But then we see in verse 5, or verse 13, that Esther comes to the king again. And she says, she asks for another day. So it's like, you know, the continuation of the violence. And why is that? Well, we're not told why. But potentially we'd see that it didn't have the fullest effect, that there was still anti-Semitic sentiments in the community, particularly in Susa, where a lot of the Jews lived. That the one day of defending themselves didn't kind of cause that anger and that violence, and so they were still fearful of their lives. And so she says, can you extend it one more day? And this is what this happens. And so this is kind of, again, sort of messy in our minds. Again, we come back and it's also probably connected to what God had originally instructed Saul to do, and he had failed to do. When he said, you know, write down and do not neglect this, that the Amalekites should be wiped out. And again, if you're kind of catching in on this series, like, why did God say to wipe out a whole, you know, group of people, Amalekites? Well, these are the people that they were so evil, and they had been so aggressive in their violence to the people of God, Israel, when they had exited Egypt, and they were wandering in the wilderness, and the Amalekites came down, and all those that were straggling, those who were pregnant, those who were elderly, those who were disabled, the Amalekites just picked these people off from behind. And God said, I will not forget what they have done to the people of God. And then it gave this instruction that they should be wiped out. So again, all these things, it's kind of hard. It's kind of messy in our minds. But we don't kind of clean up Scripture and wipe it clean and everything. This is the story. But we also have to look at the overarching story of God and see this story in the overall biblical context. Okay, so we see that there is these numbers were given, 500 the one day, 300 the next day, and then 75,000 were killed. And then the sons of Haman also, these were all people that hated the Jews and the Jews defended themselves against. This commentary that I referred to by Karen Jobes, she says this: regardless of their character, their motives, or their fidelity to God's law, the decisions that Esther and Mordecai make move events in some inscrutable way to fulfill the covenant promises of God made to his people long ago. So instead of trying to fix it all and unpack it all, the questions, this is, I think, where I feel like has helped me in understanding this, is that the narrative of Scripture that we have was never intended to show the moral goodness of people, but rather the incredible mercy of God and his providential care for his people. So even God himself said to the people in Deuteronomy 9, verse 4 to 6, he said this, "After the Lord your God has driven them out before you, do not say to yourself, 'The Lord has brought me here to take possession of this land because of my righteousness.' No, it is on account of the wickedness of these nations that the Lord is going to drive them out before you. It is not because of your righteousness or your integrity that you are going in to take possession of their land, but on account of the wickedness of these nations, the Lord will drive them out before you to accomplish what he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." Verse 6, repeated again. "Understand then that it is not because of your righteousness that the Lord your God is giving you this good land to possess. For you," he says to his own people, "you are a stiff-necked people. You're stubborn. You're proud. You're arrogant. You are not righteous. It is not because you're so great, but it is because of the promises of God and the mercy of God." All right, as we come to a conclusion of this series, I think it's important, as this series does, the story of Esther also points us to the fullness of Scripture in the gospel that we know on this side, the lens that we see through Jesus Christ. Jesus was a Jew. He was a Messiah. He came from Jews, but came for all people. And so it is possible for us today to view this story in light of another great reversal. And it's really the ultimate counter decree. See, the same Bible that tells the difficult story of Esther in its messiness, in its absence in a way of God, as we see in the book, and yet his work in the shadows, his providential care in it all, we actually see part of the overarching gospel story. See, there's a penalty of death that is irrevocable. Romans 6, verse 23 says, "The wages of sin is death." Numerous times throughout this summer, we've had campers at camp ask the question, really, why is God the way God is? Why does God decide? Why is that Adam and Eve's sin impacts us all? Couldn't God just change his mind and just say that everyone is good and everyone's okay and that sin doesn't actually bring death? Like, couldn't God just change that? Why doesn't he change his rules? Well, we can't always understand, you know, the mind of God, but we see that through Scripture, is that due to Satan's influence in leading Adam and Eve to sin, God has issued this death penalty against all mankind because we do not keep the king's laws. But he is not a wild madman pagan king. He is a holy, righteous king. And his decree is irrevocable because he is righteous and just. He cannot just overlook it and just change his mind. Lawbreakers must be punished, and the sentence of death must remain in place. He doesn't change the original decree, because that would be contrary to his holy character. But instead, he offers a counter decree, a way out, Christ as our defense. He's made a way for us to avoid the death penalty. He himself has provided our only defense against death, and that is Christ's blood shed on the cross. And that can be our response, as we're invited into that by faith, that through Jesus, we too can have light and joy and gladness and honor. I want to give you just a couple of takeaways from this book. Hopefully, as you've been processing this and unpacking some of this with us, it's caused you to consider some things about your life and also the ways that God works in direct ways and maybe indirectly in the shadows. So first takeaway is this, is that God is on the throne. God is on the throne. And nothing happens that will sidetrack his redemptive plan. This was the quote that I used from the beginning and have referred to throughout this series. It says this, is that God is working providentially in the completely secular and ungodly course of human events to save his people against all expectations and to bring all of history to culmination in Christ. There's no plot, there's no plan that can thwart God's purposes that stretch from Genesis to Revelation. Nothing can thwart God's plan. And we are part of that plan. We're part of his purpose. Second takeaway is this, is how are you more likely now to recognize God's providential care in your life? Again, directly or indirectly. There's ways that we can identify and we can say that without a doubt was God. And then there's other times where we're left with some questions and wondering. But there isn't coincidences. It's that God's hand is involved in our lives. He's involved in the details of your life. And you right now might be living in a challenging time. You might have uncertainty as to what is happening in your life, in your health, in your relationships, in your workplace, in your future. You might have some questions. But I hope that the promise that we've seen through Esther is that nothing is going to get in the way of God's plan, his redemptive purpose for our lives, and that we can trust him, even in the hard. Final takeaway is just what I ended with, is there's a great reversal. It's the curse. It's not the curse of the bambino, it's the curse of sin. It's the curse of sin, and it's been broken. The decree of death as a result of our sin is broken because of Jesus, because of his death and his resurrection. This is the hope and the reality for all who put their trust in him. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. We know there's parts of it that are uncomfortable, parts of it that we kind of wish were different, that we could kind of clean up. But Lord, we know that you worked in all the circumstances. You worked in the political system, in the military system, in the mess of kingdoms and nations. But Lord, you are the one ultimately that is on the throne. And I pray that we would be reminded as well that it is not because of our righteousness or our integrity, Lord, but it is because of your plan and ultimately for your honor and your glory, God, that we can receive this gift from you, this gift of life that brings gladness and joy to us. Amen.
I am holding on to faith, 'cause I know you'll make a way, and I don't always understand it. And I don't always get to see, but I will believe it, I will believe it. 'Cause you make mountains move, you make giants fall, you use songs of praise to shake prison walls, and I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt that you are faithful then, and you'll be faithful now. And I am standing on your word.
Thanks for joining us today at College Drive. Would you stand? We're going to sing another song if you're able to stick around. I will offer you the doxology today. And just before I do that, I just want to remind you, if you would like to give today, we have our table at the back there with our machine and everything. You can do so there, or also you can do that by e-transfer as you like, and contribute to where we're at. We're a little bit of at a shortfall. But that's pretty typical in the summer. Just remind you, there is also a page from our finance team at the table there. If you want a little bit more details on it, you can pick that up there. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord. Before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. Yeah.
Hey, thank you so much for joining our online service today at College Drive Community Church, where our mission is to be and to make disciples of Jesus. If you want to learn more about us or to partner with us, you can go to our website or you can go to our social medias for Facebook and Instagram, respectfully. And if you're wanting to be here in person, we would love to meet and connect with you and to partner with you here in our mission at College Drive. So thank you so much and have a great rest of your day. God bless.